দর্শক সবাইকে স্বাগত জানাচ্ছি চলতে চলতে অনুষ্ঠানে। আর আমাদের আজকের অতিথি বাংলাদেশে নিযুক্ত কানাডার হাই কমিশনার হিদার ক্রুডেন। হার এক্সেলেন্সি হিদার ক্রুডেন, মোস্ট ওয়েলকাম টু আওয়ার শো চলতে চলতে। হাউ আর ইউ?
আই এম গুড, থ্যাংক ইউ, হাউ আর ইউ?
আই এম ফাইন অলসো। বেসিক্যালি উইড লাইক টু টক উইথ ইউ, ওয়ান্ট টু নো ইউর সাম স্টোরিজ, স্টোরিজ অফ ইউর লাইফ, স্টোরিজ অফ ইউর চাইল্ডহুড। ফার্স্টলি আই উড লাইক টু স্টার্ট উইথ ইউর চাইল্ডহুড।
ইয়েস,
হাউ ওয়াজ দ্যাট, ক্যান ইউ রিকল?
My childhood, I confess that's actually a long time ago, but I had a very lovely childhood. I was the oldest of four children, and my father worked at a community college. He was the president of the community college, and my mother stayed at home. We had both my grandmothers and my great aunt living with us. We had four cats and a dog, and at one point we had a Vietnamese family, a boat family, also living with us. So there was always a lot of people in the house.
So you have a lot of memories. So
oh,
you
yes.
are the High Commissioner, you are a diplomat.
I am.
Do you have any plan to be a diplomat?
No.
From the very beginning?
I did not.
Then why you are?
Well, I always wanted to travel. And I always dreamed about being a diplomat. But in Canada, the process to become a diplomat is very competitive. It's very difficult. So actually, I ended up being in the right time at the right place. I joined the Government of Canada. One of my master's degrees is in public administration. And then I started working for CETA, which is the former Canadian International Development Agency. And from that, I realized I have a passion for working overseas, a passion for working in development. And the next natural step was to become a High Commissioner. So I've just been very lucky.
Very lucky. So to the Bangladeshi people, you are the Canada.
Yes.
As because you are representing your country,
I'm
you are representing
Canada.
Your government. So what's your feelings about Bangladesh?
Oh, I think Bangladesh is a country that has got incredible potential. I mean, every time people ask me this question, I say, Bangladeshis are so warm, they're so welcoming, they're so resilient, they're so entrepreneurial, because I am not entrepreneurial. So I really, you know, I'm so in awe by this. And the country, as I said, has incredible potential. I have very much enjoyed my 3 years here. I've been here for 3 years already.
Almost.
It's gone so fast. And the challenges are immense. You know, the challenges that Bangladesh faces in terms of, you know, human development, social development, economic development. But when you look at where Bangladesh was 40 years ago, they've made tremendous strides. The achievement of the MDGs 4 and 5 in primary education and maternal and child health, I mean, that's almost a miracle. So it's been fantastic to be part of that.
So life in Dhaka is really tough, especially people have a lot of objection regarding Dhaka city management, traffic jam. Do you have any such experience?
I don't think anybody that lives in Dhaka doesn't have a story about the traffic. I will tell you, I do not get in a car without having my BlackBerry, my iPad, my newspapers, my Kindle so I can read books, because I never know how long I'm going to spend in the car.
Yeah.
And so that gets a bit wearisome, I have to say.
So you have to spend many time in the road after getting all the government protocol.
Yes, I do. Well, part of, you know, representing Canada is I can't just sit in my office. I have a beautiful office. I mean, it'd be very nice to sit here. But, you know, you have to go out and you have to meet people, whether it's business people, civil society,
people.
Political people, local people, to really find out what their life is like. I mean, Baradara, it's a bit of a bubble, right? You know, this is the diplomatic zone. So it's really important to get out. And it's not easy because the traffic is bad. There's not airports everywhere in the country. But you make that effort and you go talk to people and the rewards are amazing. So I can't claim the same distinction as the U.S. ambassador. I have not visited all 64 districts, but I have visited all parts of Bangladesh, including I've been to the refugee camps in Cox's Bazar. I've been up to the Chittagong Hill Tracks. I've been to Salat. I've been up north. I've been down south. So I've been all over.
So Ambassador Mojina already completed 64
he
districts.
He did.
Yeah,
that was a lot of
finally
traveling.
Have done. And how many districts you have visited already?
You know, I've never counted.
Almost
I don't know. I honestly, I don't know how many districts I've... I'll have to get back to you on that. I know I've visited a lot, but I have never actually sat down and count them because I'm not in competition with the U.S. ambassador.
Yeah. No, that's not the matter of competition. So if you would not be an high commissioner, a diplomat, then what you would be?
Well, if I wasn't working for the government, you know, as I said, my passion is development. I've always worked in developing countries or failed or fragile states. So before I came here, I was working in Afghanistan. But if I wasn't working in development, I probably would either be a teacher or a writer. Because in no matter what I have done, I have always taught and mentored people and helped them develop. or I've written. I mean, I write reports up the yin-yang here. Those aren't very exciting things to write, but I'd love to write a novel one day.
So you are a student of English literature, and you had a silent dream of being a writer.
Yes.
So I am sure you are writing.
I write bits and pieces. I definitely write, as I said, a lot of reports and a lot of emails for work.
Literature or poetry.
Not literature or poetry, but I write. I do write letters to friends, and I do sometimes tell stories. And maybe one day when I retire, I'll put all that together. We'll see.
And then you will write your autobiography?
If anybody wants to read it, I don't know.
So, Ambassador, you have, High Commissioner, you have visited many countries.
I have
been in Afghanistan, you have been in Gaza, mm-hmm. and some critical zone in the world where life is really risky.
Yes.
Do you have any such kind of experience which make your life very risky during work?
Yes, I've had a couple of times where, you know, by the luck of God, I've been protected, I've been saved, or I've been in the right place at the right time. It is amazing, though, what you get used to. So when I was in Iraq, you know, it was at a difficult time. It was 2004, 2005. So we would take the helicopters into the green zone, and there was one time where the helicopter, something was shot at it. There was another time where one of the helicopters, when we were traveling, had technical difficulty and had an unforeseen hard landing. There was a building that I was in on the top floor, and a bomb went off next door, and you know, the building was shaking and the windows were coming out. But you do get used to things. So it becomes normal, which is a bit scary. I mean, that's when you become complacent. That's what you have to be careful of.
So, High Commissioner, many times in some parts of the world, people are killing people. Human beings are killed by human beings.
Yes.
What's your reaction regarding these issues?
It's bad. I'm sorry. I mean, you know, when there's war, when there's conflict, that's never good.
Yeah.
Good for no one. It's not good for anybody. It's not good for the common people. It's not good for families. It's not good for communities. It's not good for countries. It's not good for countries' development, social development, or economic development. And that is why it is so important to find political solutions that are durable and sustainable. And that's really the responsibility of the people themselves. The international community can try and help, but, you know, a lot of these problems are very complicated.
Madam, we have to take a short break.
Certainly.
Darshak, chotta ekta biroti nichhi, amader shonge thakben, firchi kichukkhoner moddhe. বিরতির পর আবারও স্বাগত চলতে চলতে অনুষ্ঠানে কথা বলছিলাম কানাডার হাই কমিশনার হিদার কুডেনের সাথে হিদার अगेन ওয়েলকাম উই ওয়ান্ট টু নো অ্যাবাউট ইওর ফ্যামিলি
মাই ফ্যামিলি
অ্যাবাউট ইওর প্যারেন্টস অ্যাবাউট ইওর হাজবেন্ডস অ্যাবাউট ইওর সান ইউ হ্যাভ ওয়ান সান
আই হ্যাভ ওয়ান সান
ইয়া
ওকে ওয়েল ইউ নো উই স্প্রেড অল আউট মাই প্যারেন্টস আর নাও রিটায়ার্ড দে লিভ ইন নোভা স্কোশিয়া হুইচ ইজ আ টাইনি প্রভিন্স ইন কানাডা and I am the oldest of four. My brother lives in Thailand, my sister lives in Vietnam, and my other sister lives in Halifax with my parents. My husband is also in the diplomatic service, but he's with the Australian diplomatic service. So he is the ambassador for Australia to Iran. Yeah. So we have a long distance relationship, which is often challenging, as you can imagine. And my son is in Canada, but he's in British Columbia, which is in the West Coast. Yeah. My parents are in the East Coast, and he's a tree planter.
So you are really a global citizen.
We are.
So you have to pass a very busy life, and you have to be in Dhaka, and your husband have to be in other countries, long distance. You have not direct communication with your parents. So it's a really very busy and challenging life.
It is.
Your family member didn't mind sometimes that you couldn't give them enough time.
They're very supportive, actually. My parents have always supported me in what I've wanted to do. They do worry about me. So I will say that when I went to Iraq, I didn't tell them I was going to Iraq. I told them I was going to Jordan.
Jordan.
But then my sister let the cat out of the bag, if you know that expression. And so since then, I have told them when I've been going to difficult places. So they knew when I was going to Afghanistan. My husband is equally supportive because we do the same thing. He understands the pressures that I am under. I understand the pressures that he is under. My son is not always happy when I'm in conflict zones. It hasn't given me the moral authority when I say, you know, I think that's a bit dangerous. And he says, but you went too, yeah. You know.
How old he is?
He's 29.
29.
So he's a man.
He's a man. He's not son.
But he's man still is my son. Son too. Exactly. He's still my baby.
Mom. Yeah. So regarding your diplomatic career.
Yes.
Obviously, you have to face many challenges.
Yes.
If I ask you what was the most challenging moment in your diplomatic life till now?
You know, I would say being away from my family. I mean, that's always challenging. This is my fifth posting. My first posting was in Ghana, and then I was in Iraq, and then I was in West Bank, Gaza, and then I was in Afghanistan, and then I was here in Bangladesh. So, you know, the long distance, not being able to see my family regularly is definitely a challenge, and it puts stress on relationships, and you have to really work at maintaining those relationships. But I have a passion for what I do. This is the kind of work yeah. I am very passionate about. I want to be able to make a difference, particularly to people's lives who are poor overseas. And so my family is very supportive.
But I know you have a family here in Bangladesh. Your embassy is your family. Your High Commission is your family.
And I've made some fantastic friends here. Friends that I know will stay friends with me when I leave.
And you are the family leader.
I'm the family leader. Yeah.
Here in Bangladesh. So how could you evaluate your this family?
Oh, my team?
Yeah.
Oh, they're fantastic. Yeah, I have a really strong team. I would not be able to continue at the pace that I do without the full support of my team. You know, I'm able to represent Canada because I've got this. It's a small team. Don't get me wrong. We're only 15 Canadians and 35 locally engaged staff. But I would not be able to do what I do without their help.
So they are basically your colleagues, but sometimes in any crisis, like if you feel sick or if you are in any personal crisis, obviously they will stand beside you.
Oh, absolutely.
Or you will stand beside them.
Absolutely. Yeah, yeah.
So now it's your family.
Yes, in that sense, yes, because we always help each other.
So regarding Bangladesh, you have visited some districts. You have get chance to mix with Bangladeshi people.
I have.
How could you evaluate the Bangladeshi women?
You know, as I said, Bangladeshis generally are resilient. I think the Bangladeshi women are so incredibly resilient. I have met Bangladeshi women entrepreneurs who are so creative and so passionate about trying to help women at the local level. One of the things that I am very passionate about, of course, is women's rights and child and early and forced marriage. And you know, I had an event here last week where we were raising awareness of the negative impact of child early and forced marriage. You may or may not know that last International Women's Day, we also put on a play that was called Seven, that was about seven women activists. And so we had five women ambassadors and two UN heads of UN agencies who were also women. So violence against women, women's empowerment, early forced marriage, these are all issues that are very important to me. I've been very privileged. You know, I'm a middle-class woman who had access to education in Canada. But even so, it has not always been easy. You know, we have laws that protect women, that ensure, you know, equal pay for equal value and all of that sort of thing. But there are still, you know, there are still assumptions and norms about what women can and cannot do, particularly if you have children, etc. So I have been really, really privileged. So when I go to a developing country, you know, if it's seen as useful and appropriate, I try and share my experiences to act as a role model. So young girls know it's possible to grow up one day and be a high commissioner or ambassador, or it's possible to grow up and be the prime minister. You've got a woman prime minister. You've got a woman speaker of the house. You've got women ministers. So just making sure that young girls don't sacrifice their education, that their families do not pressure them to get married early, because if they get married early and have babies early, that has such terrible economic and social consequences. You know, they drop out of school, the babies are often stunted, because the woman, you know, you physically really are not mature until you're 18 years old. So, you know, just trying to raise awareness. And violence against women, one of the NGOs that we've worked very closely with and helped set up is the Acid Survivors Foundation.
Yeah.
And I don't know if you've ever been into their premises, but you meet some of these young girls who have had acid thrown on them, and they're so resilient. Some of them have learned to dance, some of them have gone back to the workplace, and yet I think if it happened to me, I would just curl up in a ball. Like, I don't know that I would be able to take that strength from inside myself. They are so strong.
So strong.
I mean, that's really what I've learned about Bangladeshi women. They are strong.
Yeah. Hi, Commissioner. Again, we have to take a short break. Darshak, abar ekta chotto biroti nichhi, birotir porei firchi, sathe thakben. দর্শক, বিরতির পর আরেকবার স্বাগত চলতে চলতে অনুষ্ঠানে। কথা বলছিলাম কানাডিয়ান হাই কমিশনার হিদার কুডেনের সাথে। ম্যাডাম হিদার, ওয়ান্ট টু নো অ্যাবাউট ইউর হবিজ।
বাট মাই হবিজ, ও আই এম প্যাশনেট অ্যাবাউট কুকিং।
কুকিং?
ইয়েস, কুকিং, আই লাভ কুকিং। আই এম আ ভেরি প্যাশনেট অ্যামেচার শেফ। আই ডোন্ট হ্যাভ আ লট অফ টাইম টু কুক হিয়ার, বাট আই হ্যাভ আ হিউজ কালেকশন অফ কুক বুকস। আই রিড কুক বুকস ফর প্লেজার অ্যান্ড আই ডু অল অফ দ্য মেনু প্ল্যানিং। And I like to do fusion cooking. So I like to take ideas from different cuisines and mix them. So I have a lot of fun with that.
What about Bangladeshi food? Can you cook any Bangladeshi item?
I can cook Bangladeshi food. I can also cook Indian food, Thai food, and Italian food, and Mexican and European. So as I said, I like to cook and I like to combine recipes. And I like to think about food and I like to eat at good restaurants. So that's one of the things. But then to make sure I don't gain 20 pounds, because I was told when I came here that Bangladesh is a 10 kilo posting, and I can't afford to gain 10 kilos, I do yoga. So I try and balance, you know, loving food and eating well with, you know, working out and doing yoga and trying to, you know, maintain some way of balancing my stress levels.
What's your favorite food in Bangladesh? If we request you to select one single Bangladeshi food, what would be?
I have to confess, I love shingara.
Shingara?
I do.
With potato or beef?
Potato. Potato. Yeah. Absolutely potato.
You are taking?
I also love all of the different fish dishes because Bangladeshis are passionate about their fish, and I've had the hilsa many, many times, and it's very good.
You know, that's our national fish.
I do.
Yeah. So, Ambassador, if you have you have to face some critical moment here in Bangladesh regarding Bangladesh. That was the critical moment for Bangladeshis. And you and our other friends, ambassadors and high commissioner, sometimes taking initiative for the betterment of Bangladesh. So how do you evaluate the political situation?
Oh, well, I have to say, I'm very, very pleased that the cartels have stopped. I mean, I think everybody is pleased that the cartels have stopped. They were not good. The violence in the lead up to the last set of elections was not helpful for the Bangladesh economy or for social development. I think all of the surveys are showing that Bangladeshis are very pleased that we have some stability and we have some security. So now the economy can get back on track. People can work. So, you know, I think that's a good thing.
Yeah. So how do you evaluate the economy of Bangladesh? You know, Bangladesh is doing a really better for last 10 years in all aspect of economic affairs.
It is, but you know, I mean, it's been a bit of the Bangladesh miracle that I alluded to before, but for Bangladesh to hit middle income status, the growth needs to be double digits. And the latest forecast from the World Bank is 6.2% economic growth. And that, you know, I have to say most Western countries would kill for 6.2 economic growth. But for Bangladesh to hit middle income status by 2021, which is the, you know, the goal, you need double-digit growth. And it's possible, it is possible, but it's going to take a lot of investment in infrastructure and, you know, in strengthening governance systems, etc. Digital Bangladesh, I think, is a very good initiative. That's one of the Prime Minister's initiatives. So there's a lot of work that still needs to be done.
So beyond the High Commissioner of Canada, you have a life.
Yes, I actually do have a life.
That is a personal life of Hidar Kuden.
Yes.
So you have some hobbies, you have some style, you have some fashions, and you are wearing saris.
Yes, I am.
Good saris. So what's about your fashion? And you are still looking very young.
Oh, thank
you. What's the secret of this?
Well, I have to say, I'm very pleased that you think I look young. I do exercise and I watch what I eat. But I love clothes, I love fabrics, I love textiles. That's why I have collected so many saris. I have over 30 saris.
30?
30.
Yeah.
So, you know, as I said, my mother's a weaver. My mother actually weaves. So I've appreciated the work that goes into hand-woven textiles for a long, long time. So I've always collected those wherever I've been around the world. But I also, you know, I like to buy clothes, so I try and dress reasonably well. Yeah. And as I said, I exercise, so I think maybe that's the secret. And I've got good genes. I take after my mother.
Yeah. Which sharis are your favorite? There are many kinds of sharis here in Bangladesh.
Yeah, well, it depends. I mean, I love silks, but they're not always practical, right? So also the cottons and wools are not so popular here, but in Canada, wool is very important in the wintertime. It gets very, very cold. Yeah. So having good quality wool sweaters and coats to keep you warm in the middle of winter is absolutely a necessity.
Ambassador, what are the big challenges for Bangladesh, and especially with the relation with Canada?
Well, I should talk a little bit about our development program, because Canada has been a long-standing development partner for Bangladesh. We were one of the first countries to recognize Bangladesh after independence. We provided over $4 billion in development assistance. Our priorities right now are children and youth and sustainable economic growth. So under children and youth, we focus on primary education and we focus on maternal and child health. Maternal and child health is also a priority of our Prime Minister, Prime Minister Harper. So we are working very closely with the government, with the Ministry of Education and with the Ministry of Health. And we are very pleased that Bangladesh has met MDGs 4 and 5, but there's still much more work that needs to be done in terms of quality, both of the health system and of the education system, and access. For example, education, making sure that young girls stay in school, get through the secondary levels. On the sustainable economic growth, we've been working very closely with the government and with the ILO for skills development and for labor rights. As you know, following the Rana Plaza disaster, we became very involved in trying to improve workplace safety, but we're also trying to improve skills development, because not everybody can go to university. And your biggest export are your human resources. Yeah. You need to move from exporting very low-level workers to mid-level skilled workers, and then your remittances will go up, and then your economy will increase. So this is what we're trying to do in conjunction with the government.
So, Excellency, what the witness of Rana Plaza tragedy here in Bangladesh?
I was here.
It's a very tragic experience for all over the world, I would like to say. And Bangladesh would like to remove this kind of challenge. So what are the basic challenges of garment industry here in Bangladesh?
Well, I mean, the Rana Plaza tragedy was a mix of a number of different factors. I mean, the inspections were... You had good laws in the books, they just were not being followed, right? And that's across all sectors. So we have to do better in terms of implementing the current regulations and the current laws. The garment owners need to invest in safety. And there's two organizations, the Accord and the Alliance, that are working with the private sector in Bangladesh to help increase the level of safety in the factories. The ILO is working with the government to increase their capacity. Canada is providing $8 million to the ILO, along with the Netherlands and the United Kingdom. So it's a $24 million project. And there was a meeting yesterday in Brussels that was reviewing the progress that has been made in the Sustainability Compact. So a lot of work has been done over the last year, but it's just a massive challenge.
Heather, we have to finish. We would like to finish with your dream.
What's your dream?
Right now, and who has not yet achieved?
You know, there are so many things I still want to do in the world, right? And I've told you, I love writing, and eventually I would like to write something. There's so many countries I still want to travel and visit to. So, you know, I just take life as it comes. I've been so lucky with my career and with my life. And, you know, I thank my lucky stars for that. So I can't point to one thing and say, this is what I really want, because I have to be grateful for what life brings me.
Thank you, High Commissioner. Thanks for your valuable time.
Thank you very much.
দর্শক, শেষ করতে হচ্ছে আজ. কথা বলছিলাম কানাডিয়ান হাই কমিশনার হিদার কুডেনের সাথে. পরবর্তী পর্বে দেখা হবে অন্য কোনো অতিথির সাথে. ভালো থাকবেন, সুস্থ থাকবেন.